This is Vivica Williams, and you're watching Head to Head. Ukraine recently provided regulatory agencies with formalized guidelines on open data. Now, this is a crucial step towards transparency and development in Ukraine. So how exactly can open data serve the people, and what are the benefits of these type of projects? To talk more about this, we're joined in the studio today by Vira Nedzvedska, Knowledge Management Coordinator of E-Governance for Accountability and Participation Program. Vira, hello. Thank you for joining us.
Hello. Pleased to be here.
So first, let's talk a little bit about open data. Now, I know that this is a crucial issue. This is very important to any organization being able to make use of what a government creates. So, for example, I know that for NGOs, let's say, to be health NGOs, to be able to tell people about issues in their community, maybe even things like pollution levels in a lake, they need to be able to get information from that agency. And that agency needs to be able to provide that in a way that an NGO can use it. So tell me a little bit more in our public about this very often confusing topic on open data. What is it, and how can it be used?
Yes, sure. Let's start with the very idea of open data. So open data, it's not only some information with free access or under free license, so to speak, but this is information in special format, machine-readable format. It means that this information could be easily processed by computers and therefore could be quickly processed and provided with easy access 24/7.
Because earlier it was you go to an office and yes, and you can get a stack of forms and someone's going to have to spend hours, months, years trying to go through it and create connections. So with this, you might be able to receive materials that can be easily put into a program that can create data sets, can put together correlations. So this is what we're talking about.
Yeah, that's right. Now you even could not leave your home and have access to a large scale of information. And not only that, but open data make a significant impact into economy now. Recently, there was a research funded by the TAPAS. TAPAS means Transparency and Accountability in Public Services. It's International Technical Aid Program. So they funded the research, and they estimated direct economic impact to Ukraine's economy up to $700 million. They even suggest that up to 2025, those effect would succeed $1.4 billion. So now you can see why a number of experts call open data a new oil of modern economy. And those impacts go through mainly two ways. First, it make possible to cost saving and make better decision. It's true both for public sector and private sector. As you said, private companies and NGOs also use open data in their strategic planning, and in that way they can save money, they can make better decision. Also, open data creates more revenues for businesses, because there are a lot of different startups which provides scratch new products and services for consumers based on open data. And those products and services never existed till recently, so they never existed before open data was launched.
So can you give us an example so we can get some more of a better concrete understanding of what kinds of products and services have really come about because of open data?
To put it more simple for our people, we buy some medicine almost every day. especially if you have aged parents or whatever.
Chronic illnesses.
That's right. And there is a service called Tabletki UA. So they collect open data from pharmacies, and they provide for consumers up-to-date data on prices and where you can buy, where their nearest pharmacies with the lowest prices is located.
Well, this is a great, I've actually used one of these sources and not really realizing that this was a product of open data, being able to make better decisions because before, of course, you're calling different pharmacies, you're calling around trying to find the best price, and here this information then is so this is one way of using it. What are some other ways in the public sphere that using open data?
In public sphere is more about open registrars. It's when you start your business online or get some documents, even licenses from the government, staying at home. And probably you heard about this recent initiative of the Minister of Infrastructure, again supported by the TAPAS program. I'm proud of my colleagues. They created this e-cabinet of transport. Not only those who conducted business in transportation could obtain licenses or interfere with government authorities through this e-cabinet online, but you and I can sign in and see full information about the transport company, whether they have a license, whether they have some technical problems before.
Maybe any time they've had lawsuits or who they're involved in, who they're tied
to. Right.
This adds a lot of ability to make better decisions, especially for people. And I know that this is something, you know, even recently there's been, of course, very frequently protests against developers or who have people have paid for apartments. It seems to be very common. And these developers then don't build the home. Is this something that would someone be able to use this type of resource to be able to find information in this way, in this these type of issues?
Sure. There is some project, actually it's under development, which aims to provide consumers with information about developments. It also will be online. They collect open data from different state registrars and aggregate it in order to see a whole legal history, a whole history of lawsuits, the same principle as with the transport companies we mentioned.
Oh, that's excellent. Because I do know that's an issue with being able to see what's going on will definitely help be able to deal with corruption and put this, I know so many people feel helpless when it comes to a larger company or powerful people, and this gives this type of empowerment to people.
Right. And it's a possibility for people to make fully informed decision based not on advertising, but on some objective data. And it's a way to protect their interest before it's going to court.
This is excellent, because this has definitely been something hard to in the past to do. And speaking of that, I know Ukraine actually is in the top of countries around the world when it comes to open data. And it's in some ways been called a revolution, because it is quite using what other countries have done, maybe, and being able to step in at this point and really accelerate how open data is used. So tell us a bit about the history of open data in Ukraine and why it's become such a driving force and often an example to other countries or cities.
There aren't so many international rankings where Ukraine place top position. And surprisingly, in Open Data Barometer, surprisingly for our audience, I mean, in Open Data Barometer, Ukraine rank place in top 15 best top 50 best countries, and we leave behind such European neighbors as Portugal, Poland, Bulgaria, Greece, and some others. Some experts even called it Ukraine's open data revolution, because it all mainly starts from 2014, which is more important to know. The first movements were based on public-private cooperation, because when in 2014 state portal data.gov.ua, where open data aggregates, initially it was launched by NGO Social Boost in cooperation with the government. And now it's a widely used source of information where you can find a big variety of data from different state authorities and local authorities, again, in order to make a more informed decision, which is important in your all spheres of your life, really.
And I guess I could even see it starting even earlier than this, in 2014, in the days when there were the groups of people sitting around with shredded copies of documents from Yanukovych's offices, you know, roomfuls of people putting this together slowly, piece by piece, and really giving that to people, this idea that we want to have access to information and you don't want to be until you can evaluate it. So I can see that it has a very personal history here when it comes to open data in Ukraine.
That's right. And scale of our access to public data has changed significantly. So we should know and we should use it, because revolution is in progress and we should prevent it from being jeopardized by some corrupted officials who want to take it for themselves in order to corrupt the law.
And this is where we see, and we come back to the idea of now having standards, which is absolutely imperative that you can have open data, as you said, revolution, but you need to then make this a standard thing. So it's not a one-time event, but something that can be repeated, and the standards are there, and it's replicated, and everyone's on the same page. And so that's what we're seeing now with these standards that have been introduced to regulatory agencies.
Oh, yes. This standard was introduced just recently, and I'm proud to belong to a regulatory map project team, which designed it along with our colleagues from text.org.ua, another profound NGO, and State Regulatory Service of Ukraine. You must know that the government requires as many as 600 data sets to be published. Huh. But until recently, there was no clear, not guidelines, but template for government bodies how to form and publish those information. My colleagues and I, we are working in the sphere of regulatory policy. To put it simple, regulatory policy is about rules for conducted business. And taking into account that enabling business environment is an integral part of almost every strategic document in Ukraine, both on national and local levels, regulatory policy is one of key importance for economical growth. We have deregulation reform in progress. Absolutely. On central level. And the central government puts large efforts to deregulate business activity, to eliminate some administrative burdens, to make procedures more simple. But then we have over 10,000 local authorities, which are also authorized to govern business, and they have the unfortunately, archaic procedures and corrupted procedures, which are still unchanged. Right. And that's why we suggested this regulatory map system, which will aggregate open data from regulatory authorities and provide some analytics and some easy and user-friendly information also for businesses, for experts, and for public officials themselves. But in order to create this system, we need open data to be used. Yeah. And if you go through this data.gov UA portal, you see that there are only 60 data sets from regulatory authorities published. So it's less than 1% from 10,000 authorities. Yeah. Right. So in a way to help authorities to do it and to do it properly so that we can use this information after that, we designed this standard as a template to be used while fulfilling your data set.
So this is the beginning of many things. Templates are apps. I'm a believer of templates and standards because they absolutely ease production and make it easier to comply. And that's one of the major things, the major issues they're looking at, and especially from the local authorities and smaller organizations.
Sure, it's like a pilot project, an idea, and if successfully implemented, it would be an example for all other authorities in many other spheres how to maintain with data set, how to maintain they in unified form. Again, at data portal, you can find data in PDF files, and it jeopardizes the whole idea of open data because PDF files couldn't be easily processed here, so they're not open.
Well, we are looking forward then to seeing the results of this project, specifically more access, more information, more things that we can use. Thank you so much for being with us today.
Thank you.
And this was Vira Nedzvedska, Knowledge Management Coordinator of the EGAP program. Thank you for watching and stay tuned for more.